The 2017 elections are now behind us. Controversy, however, abounds regarding the integrity of the election process. The opposition avers that the Jubilee victory was actually no victory at all. To quote David Ndiaye, Jubilee captured the Independent Election and Boundaries Commission and intimidated the judiciary. The official chauffeur and bodyguard of the Deputy Chief Justice was shot at days before the Supreme Court was to rule on the presidential election petition arising from the October 2017 repeat election. Government then declared the day of the ruling as a public holiday, thus causing some judges not to appear, leading to an adjournment on account of a lack of quorum. The EBG was captured by Jubilee, employing their most competent commissioners, one a computer expert heavily trained by the defunct Kenya Posts and Telecommunications Corporation, and the other a versatile personality with requisite interpersonal skills to maneuver any corporate terrain. Add former Cabinet Minister Raphael Tuju and Cambridge Analytica and you have a formidable team. Cambridge Analytica is a privately held company that combines data mining and data analysis with strategic communication for the electoral process. In 2015, it became known as the data analysis company working initially for Ted Cruz's presidential campaign. In 2016, after Cruz's campaign had faltered, CA worked for Donald Trump's presidential campaign and on the United Kingdom's Brexit. It is instructive to note that CA's role and impact on those campaigns has been disputed, and is the subject of criminal investigations in the two countries. There are serious moral and ethical questions that Jubilee must address regarding the recruitment of this rogue organization. Whilst the role and exact impact effect of Cambridge Analytica is still under scrutiny, legal, moral and integrity issues arise as to the implications of the governing party Jubilee acquiring and sharing the data of millions of Kenyans with a private company for their selfish benefit. They are also known to have been recruited to portray the woke community as inherently violent on social media, thus justifying the government deployment of police with live ammunition that killed hordes in Siaya, Homa Bay, Kisumu, Mathare, Kibra, and Kawangware. Almost all the victims of the government-induced police violence in Nairobi were from the woke community, causing many to silently wonder whether every police bullet automatically targeted woke. NASA's push for electoral justice and reform is, therefore, not entirely misplaced. Kenya's experience with electronic voting in 2007, 2013 and 2017 has shown that a presidential candidate with a modicum of popularity and blessed with financial resources to manipulate the electoral process and the electorate, whether directly or via proxy, can actually win hands down. This is not an attack on the current leadership status quo, but a red flag for state capture. It is little wonder then that the opposition goes on to say that present-day Kenya is a marriage encumbered by irreconcilable differences. It's an open secret that when a marriage has irreconcilable differences, divorce is on the horizon. Why then are we surprised by calls for secession when it has become increasingly clear that leadership in this country will in future be the forte of a select wealthy clique? This situation is fueling corruption as government officials plot to loot public funds and thereafter use the ill-gotten youth to propel themselves to electoral leadership positions. Electoral injustice and lack of communication, dialogue is also leading to the hardening of political positions, with NASA leader Raila Odinga now threatening to stage a presidential swearing-in ceremony this month. Clearly he is not willing to let his dream die like a raisin in the sun. This action has the potential of complicating our political equation, leading to further violence.